so stop asking! We review Medal of Honor Rising Sun, Swing into Action in Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy, and Someone Has Awfully High Self-Esteem in Mario Kart Double Dash.
I'm
the winner. Yeah, sure you are! It's game time! Please welcome Dance Sensations, Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
That's an invitation to disaster.
You could do a little dance.
No.
Welcome to X-Play. We have one of the biggest shooting titles and one of the biggest racing titles of the season on today's show. And we're going to tell you which one to buy and which one you should run away from.
Yes, we have the new Medal of Honor game. So you can stop bombarding us with the email about where is it.
They're just excited. And we're also going to review Mario Kart Double Dash. Here's my prediction. You, like me, will be playing it constantly.
Plus, we have yet another Mario Party.
Party! An action title with mummies.
And I hit the streets to find out what real people are playing.
Not real people?
No, I'm a facsimile.
But first, a game everyone wants to know about. And by everyone, I mean the people who send us viewer mail about it every 5 seconds.
It's the latest installment in one of the most successful World War II series out there, and the first to take place in the Pacific Theater. Here's a review of Medal of Honor Rising Sun.
This is the first thing you see when you start up Medal of Honor Rising Sun.
Nice logo. Oh, look, an opening cutscene. Okay, I'll watch.
Move it, you maggots, move it! Top side, let's go on a double, hurry up!
Holy crap, I'm playing already? That's right, folks. No menu, no press start to play, no messing around with settings and options. Just grab your gun and get moving, soldier! As games go, this is one hell of a beginning. Predictably, Rising Sun begins with the Japanese raid on Pearl Harbor. This mission is an awe-inspiring, balls-out action sequence that, well, it doesn't take much skill, but man, is it amazing to play through. Unfortunately, the rest of the game fails to live up to that auspicious beginning. What we have here is a game franchise that's starting to get that not-so-fresh feeling. Here's the problem. There's not much in Rising Sun that we haven't seen before and been done better everywhere else. Wherever you go, be it jungle, town, or village, the combat feels unremarkable. This is partly because the controls feel a little sluggish, especially when trying to aim precisely, and because of the shoot the bad guy that pops up game mechanic. But it's mostly because of the enemy AI. They're just plain stupid. Also, the level design is merely average. By far my favorite trick is that squad of Japanese soldiers that charge your position only after you've parked your butt behind a machine gun emplacement. Yoo-hoo, soldier man! I've got a big manly machine gun, you can come out now! I'm beginning to think this is why Japan lost the war. But it's not all bad. The music is top-notch and as good as previous entries in the series. And there are a couple of memorable moments. The most memorable being the machine gun-mounted elephant you get to ride as he charges through the jungle. That was fun! Silly, but fun! And the midnight raid on Guadalcanal contains a few surprises. But these moments don't come often enough, which is sad given that the single-player campaign is painfully short. At least there's multiplayer. If you have a friend, you can play through the campaign co-op. Medal of Honor isn't a disaster, but it is a step back from what was achieved in Allied Assault and Frontline. Take away the stirring musical score and Spielbergian earnestness, and you've got just another average first-person shooter. We've got a rating for average games. That would be a 3 out of 5.
You got that right.
That was easier.
Knock it off. And you listen up, Marines. You take a good long look. I hope none of you ever see a day like this again. Or nobody will ever know what it was.
All right, Nagin, have to consider that all the other Medal of Honor games have been great, which is why this one really does feel like such a letdown. Now, if you have a PC and you want some of that World War II action, go out and get Call of Duty. You will not.
That's
you will
true.
Not
so that game
time.
Has better AI, has better. It has better everything.
Everything is better. Now, moving on, it's time for the fifth Mario Party game.
Dude, the party's been going on forever. The keg is tapped out. Someone spilled salsa on the rug. And Luigi, he passed out on the couch.
Yeah, he's been there like 3 days.
Yeah.
It's been creepy. Okay, now, for those of you who aren't familiar with the series, Mario Party is something of, well, it's a glorified board game.
That's true, okay, but it's actually the mini games that keep it interesting. And even the fifth time around, it's pretty fun. Here's our review of Mario Party 5.
Another year, another Mario Party. Wait, this is the party? Where's the hookers and coke?
Stop!
For God's sake, Mario throws one lame party. Nintendo brings you more of the same in Mario Party 5. This party is all about mini-games. There are more than 70 of these tiny, fuzzy, cutesy-wootsy gems in several categories. Some rely strictly on chance, like in this one where the competitors both pull random ropes and someone wins.
Finish!
Yes, I'm the winner!
Others are simple button mashers, like this game where you hit the A and B buttons as many times as possible to pop all your opponent's balloons. The single-player mode and multiplayer party mode both consist of a board game that's just an excuse to string the mini-games together. It's pretty slow-paced, but luckily the controller gives a little shake to wake you up when it's your turn. Mario Party is, of course, all about the party, despite the distinct lack of illicit activity, and there are plenty of other multiplayer game modes to entertain the throng.
Finish!
There's the Super Duel mode, where you build your own battle machines, and the bonus mode, with ice hockey, a card party, and beach volleyball, though DOA this ain't. The game's for kids, but there's so many text screens, I don't know which child is going to be able to sit through them all. This is what happened when I asked for instructions. I don't play games to read. Stop at the text screens. Stop, they're hurting. The game is cute, with a capital C. It's like a marshmallow peep covered in sprinkles with a cherry on top, surrounded by puppy dogs and a little fuzzy kitten. The sound effects are terrible. There are very few actual voices. Most of the dialogue is supported by half-hearted grunts and cheers. I mean, parties are supposed to have good music, aren't they? Thanks. That's much better. Really. It's definitely aimed at a younger audience, but the mini-games are fun for us older folks from the MTV generation. Mario Party gets a cavity-inducing 3 out of 5. The colors burn my eyes!
My eyes have been singed with cuteness! This is how I suffer for you people!
Apparently for Morgan, the party is over.
Yeah, until after the commercial anyway.
Coming up, everybody switch seats! It's Mario Kart Double Dash!
Hey, no. Hey.
Okay, here.
Here. Mm-mm.
All right,
my man.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. Everyone's talking double because of Domino's new Double Melt Pizza. Layer upon layer of flavor with a creamy blend of cheeses and herbs between two thin crusts. Buy your medium one topping Double Melt Pizza for $9.99 and get any second medium pizza for just $5 more.
Hey, don't.
Get the door. It's Domino's new Double Melt Pizza.
Part was the pressure. Phone calls at home, phone calls at work, letters in the mail.
It was nice to help. Since Debt Free works with thousands of creditors, we got his interest lowered and his penalties eliminated.
Every day, thousands of people call Debt Free, a nonprofit organization.
I was snapping at everyone, on edge all the time. I just didn't know how to deal with it.
I think it was the first good news she'd heard in a long time. I explained everything Debt Free could do to help her, and we figured out she could pay off her debts in 5 years and still have money left over every month.
I wanted to do something. I just didn't know where to start.
I showed her she could make just one monthly payment, and she didn't need to borrow money to do it.
Stop running from debt. Call Debt Free today.
I'm back to my old self. I'm glad I called Debt Free.
I'm not snapping at people anymore.
If you're overwhelmed by debt, gather your bills and call Debt Free now.
I'm getting out of debt and I'm doing it myself. And I'm pretty proud of that.
Sir Kill-A-Lot, Mr. Psycho, Fluffy, the world's greatest metallic murder machines in an all-or-nothing battle to the death. Get that toaster out of here. This rig is for robots. Robot Wars, new episode tonight at 10.
It's time for G4 Tech TV's Digital Digs Dash. Want to win one of four $25,000 shopping sprees? Then get the code.
Webcam.
Now log on to g4techtv.com/digitaldigsdash and enter the code. Watch every night between 7 p.m. and 1 a.m. Eastern to get all four codes for more chances to win. The Digital Digs Dash, brought to you by Circuit City.
Gather ye rosebuds while ye may. It's Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
Welcome back to X-Play.
We love Mario Kart.
You love Mario Kart.
And anyone who thinks the cutesy racing title for kids has clearly never tried playing it because it's more addictive than crack. Not that any of us would know firsthand about crack.
Why are you looking at me?
Here's our review of Mario Kart.
At long last, the core stable of GameCube titles is complete. They've got Mario, Metroid, Zelda, and now Mario Kart. And let me tell you right now, Double Dash was worth the wait. This game has one big innovation that's immediately apparent. Now there are two riders on each kart. The characters take turns driving and launching devastating attacks on the competition. Okay, maybe devastating is a bit extreme. But all the classic attacks are here. Turtle shells, banana peels, and turbo mushrooms all bring you back to a time when gaming was about shrinking your opponents with a well-placed thunderbolt rather than whacking prostitutes with a bat. In addition, each character has their own fancy new weapon. Mario and Luigi have fireballs. Yoshi has an exploding egg. Donkey Kong has the Mega Banana of Doom, and so on. The addition of an extra rider gives Mario Kart a dash of strategy absent in previous incarnations. It won't affect your driving much. The characters have the same simple, elegant driving style we all remember fondly. Some characters are heavier than others, though. For example, racing with Baby Mario and Luigi will give you quicker acceleration, whereas Wario's Pimpin' Caddy has better top speed. But the real difference is in the combat. Twice the riders, twice the weapons, twice the boom! Time for a giant spiky shell smackdown! Winning races will unlock new carts, most of which are slight upgrades of standard carts. For example, here's the Princess Buggy, now in fashionable taupe. Also unlockable are these special cup horses, which kind of sounds like a cod piece for the short bus set, but we still love this triptastic rainbow road. And what would a Mario Kart game be without the excellent multiplayer options? Double Dash has a whole slew of them. Play with a friend in the two-player co-op mode, or go head-to-head in 2-to-4-player races and battles. Of course, since it's a Nintendo game, there's no online support. But you can link up to 8 GameCubes in a LAN for 8-player goodness. Mario Kart Double Dash easily lives up to the glory of its predecessors and serves as a perfect example of what a Nintendo game should be. Easy to pick up, with just enough challenge to keep you coming back for more. And the multiplayer options will provide hours of entertainment for you and your kin. We give Mario Kart Double Dash a power-sliding, egg-tossing, butt-smacking 5 out of 5.
Woohoo! I'm the winner!
Okay, this game was flawless on the N64, and now, even though that's impossible, it's better on the GameCube.
And if you're anything like me, you're more than a little disappointed the Double Dash doesn't have an online component. Okay, I mean, sure, you can get up to 16 players on a LAN and play together, but I want online play.
I want online play now. Well, we can help you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, actually, even with that matter, an outfit calling themselves the Warp Pipe Project, Warp Pipe Project, have found a way to fool your GameCube into actually playing online.
Yes, and you know, you can find out how to do it on our website.
That's techv.com/xplay. And you know, since this game really is about the multiplayer, and we really like playing it, we're going to show more of you what you want to see, which is split screen competition.
Yeah.
All right, so here we go. We're on Peach Beach. I'm actually playing Princess Beach up there at the top with little baby Koopa.
I'm playing.
And there
baby
we go.
Mario.
Oh, that was bad. That was a terrible start on my fart. Oh, my fault. Did I say that word?
Yes.
No, I didn't. See, that's the fun about Mario Kart is that you'll start to make inappropriate rhymes all the time.
This game really is all about, like, you know, picking up this game and playing.
And doing the multiplayer. It's tough for me to do this and talk at the same time, but you know, it's funny, while really we wanted to see the online play, as you're going to start seeing, you may have already seen with Morgan and I, there's something really fun about being in the same room with friends and yelling at one another as you play horribly nasty tricks.
Yes.
And as you start to beat them.
And so I'm playing with baby Mario here and Yoshi, so my car has smaller people on it. So as you see, my start was
a little slow. Better maneuverability there, but your top speed isn't too good. Now,
I
have Koopa and Princess Peach. So I'm just kind of middle of the road. Why?
You zapped me. Did you zap me? Did you zap me?
Yeah, I did zap you. All right, there we go. Well, that's just a taste of the fun. As you can tell from both the review and from this, this is great.
Okay, we're going to play. We'll be right back.
All right.
I'm going backwards.
Brought to you by Mountain Dew, the people who brought you Mountain Dew.
Supposed to add this.
Snoop wants to know when to add the fabric softener.
Tricky. Depends whether it's top-loading machine or front-loading.
Snoop does his own laundry. That's hot.
Snoop, you're cuddly enough as it is.
Didn't your mother teach you anything?
Fabric softener. So that's how those hip-hop guys get all the chicks.
The new T-Mobile Sidekick 2. With IM, phone, web, and more.
Everybody needs a sidekick.
Panasonic introduces high-definition plasma TV with the most beautiful picture in the world. Yours.
The most beautiful picture. I'm pretty sure it's mine.
Just snap and share your pictures instantly with built-in photo viewer. It's a whole new generation of high-definition plasma TV from Panasonic. Call for your free HD plasma guide now. Panasonic. Ideas for life.
Evanescence, anywhere but home, the two-disc DVD and CD set. The DVD includes a complete concert shot live in Paris, behind-the-scenes footage, and the Evanescence music video collection. Plus, a full-length live audio CD, including Going Under, Bring Me to Life, My Immortal, and a previously unreleased track. Evanescence, anywhere but home. Get the DVD. Order now.
In these times of too much credit card debt, are you getting caught trying to balance your credit card problems as you try to balance your life? The consequences are serious. But there is hope. There's 800 Credit Card Debt, an approved debt management company established to get you back on solid ground.
If you have between $2,500 and $40,000 in credit card debt, then 800 Credit Card Debt can help eliminate credit card penalties, reduce interest rates, and make your monthly payments smaller.
They negotiated my payments down substantially from $300 a month to $135.
My interest rates on all four cards were between 22 to 29%. They lowered my interest rates to 4 to 11%.
It went down from $20,000 to $18,000 to $16,000 to $15,000.
At a much faster rate than I could have done myself.
Call for your free and confidential credit card debt analysis. Call in the next 5 minutes to see how fast you can get out of debt. 1-800-453-1306.
Now in glorious Smell-O-Vision, it's Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
Glorious. Welcome back to X-Play.
Every once in a while, we like to send Adam out amongst the masses to see what sunlight is really like.
It burns.
So does Mario Party. Did you not hear me complaining?
Yeah, I did.
Oh.
Here's what the gamers have to say. Okay, 20 seconds or less, describe the most favorite game you've ever played in your life and why.
Final Fantasy Tactics, because it has great depth, and I played that for probably over 100 hours straight sometimes, you know? It's just a great game.
All right, time's up.
Grand Theft Auto Vice City. Just like to be able to get out and beat people up and steal a car.
Final Fantasy Tactics.
Vice City. You get to kill people, steal cars. Killing people's fun.
So, I mean, if someone offered you a game where you could help the ladies across the street, offer a lot of hugs, and make really nice breakfasts for people, that just wouldn't appeal to you?
Well, if you stole our canes and beat them over the head, maybe, but,
So you're more of a pro-social kind of guy.
Oh, totally.
The Civilization series, because it has such great replay value.
Dude, you're the first person all day long that didn't say Final Fantasy or Grand Theft Auto to that answer.
That's kind of sad.
Need for Speed 3. Once you get into the advanced levels, the cars try to kill you.
Now we're moving on to well-dressed gamers.
Any Madden game.
The Silent Hill game.
Xevious. No one has played that game. That was on Nintendo, probably back in the early 80s, late 90s.
In the early 80s or the late 90s?
Early 80s, late 90s, on Nintendo.
What is your worst game that you've ever played, like a terrible gaming memory?
Pulse Racer for the Xbox. That was horrible. Even for $9.99, I wouldn't buy it.
NBA Showdown or something like that. I was bored. I was disgusted.
What's a bad game?
You ever play Superman 64 for the N64?
Oh, yeah, that is a bad game. There we go.
You know, I wake up at night screaming still from having to review that game.
Frogger.
The original Frogger?
The original Frogger. I hate it.
Masters of Orion 3 and how crappy it was.
Yeah, I've had more fun using Excel, personally.
Need for Speed 1 really sucked for me.
Bad Dudes was a very terrible game. Someone should have sued someone over that.
No, I don't know why everybody likes Tetris.
You don't like Tetris? I think this is the first time this has ever happened. You don't like Tetris?
I want you to look directly in the camera and just say, like Tetris.
I don't like Tetris. Sorry for everybody.
That's just amazing.
You didn't like Tetris? Even kids and old people like Tetris?
I was actually taken aback by that, but I was fascinated by the Bad Dudes. Dude, now in the game itself, how the hell does the president get kidnapped by ninjas?
And more importantly, why do they send a couple of Double Dragon ripoffs to go save him from the ninjas?
See, that's a ridiculous game concept. I'm so disgusted, I'm gonna go back to playing Mario Kart where you throw mushrooms and get attacked by penguins. I'm out of here.
Coming up, lose weight doing supernatural yoga in Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy.
As a proud Earthlink employee, I swear I'll do my part to help protect you from the bad internet.
I promise to hate pop-up ads as much as you do.
I promise we're going to give you good tools to protect your children.
And I promise we won't rest until your inbox is free of spam emails like Hot Girls Want You and Why Be Bald.
Free blocking tools, free protection features. That's better internet. Call now and get 6 months of dial-up at half price.
I go out and I look for ways to stop viruses and scams and spyware and all the stuff that's going on your machine.
We just sit there and create new technologies every day to help people go on the internet, and that's really exciting to me.
So you can expect that we're going to help you. We're going to take your problem and treat it like it's our problem, and we're going to work it until it's solved.
I promise. I promise.
More access options, free blocking tools. That's better internet. Right now, get 6 months of dial-up at half price featuring Earthlink Accelerator. Call 800-827-0142 or visit these retailers. Earthlink revolves around you.
3 years from now, I can see myself in a house of my own and still learning the trade. Now, I'm an EOA technician. Basically, I deal with the satellite linking between locomotives. I got my associate's and bachelor's degree from ITT Tech. At ITT Tech, they took me through everything from basic components, electronics, all the way through software programming, very quickly. I really enjoyed school. ITT Tech definitely helped me increase my potential. I like to snowboard a lot, go to the beach, ride horses, just have fun. I remember I did roof construction. It burned me up. I thought, I better get in school. The next thing I knew, I was there.
We are educators helping people build a foundation for the rest of their lives. ITT Technical Institute, education for the future. To find out more, call 1-800-327-1172 or visit us on the web. Take advantage of our new programs that include on-campus and flexible online courses to better fit your busy lifestyle. Call 1-800-327-1172 to apply.
Enter the Digital Digs Dash Watch to Win sweepstakes and grab yourself a $25,000 shopping spree at Circuit City. Watch G4 Tech TV every night from 7 to 1 a.m. Eastern to get the codes. Then log on to g4techtv.com/digitaldigsdash and enter the codes to win one of four grand prizes or daily cash prizes. You can enter up to four times a day starting tonight through the 21st. So you better watch if you want to win. The Digital Digs Dash, brought to you by Circuit City.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
Hey, welcome back to X-Play. We have an action game filled with mummies and puzzles.
Yes, we have a review of Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy.
Which used to be called Sphinx and the Shadow of Set.
Which used to be called Sphinx.
Which used to be called, stop changing the damn title already! Here's our review of Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy.
Yeah.
Where do you find a bunch of yakking birds, a cute lion, and a lot of whining deities? If you said Madonna's London townhouse, yeah, you'd be wrong. Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy is an all-out adventurama of activity that will take you to the four corners of the gaming universe. You'll start the game as the feline demigod Sphinx. After a few wise words from a wrinkly relic, you'll set off with your out-for-himself counterpart along a treacherous trail of danger. This game barely lets you get familiar with challenge sets before it develops new ones to throw your way. Sphinx collects useful items to assist him on his quest. The in-game cast present you with an array of objectives that you'll begin to lose track of as you switch between characters. Switch characters, you say? That's right. A handy transporter shuttles you between mystic realms and introduces you to little King Tut here. Tut, and his later form as the Cursed Mummy, allow you to confront the game with a fresh personality for problem solving. Sphinx prefers the direct approach. He hacks, he smotes, he scores! Tut and his mummy self do the creep, sneak, and listen. The mummy is prone to bumble into things. The rub here is, he's dead, so nothing can really hurt him. As in this humorous poke at the third dimension. Of course, there's always the bottomless abyss. Nobody likes the bottomless abyss. The graphics and interactive elements are rich in detail here. There's also barge loads of side puzzles for cash and skill collection, which a little Sphinx needs to get ahead. A bestiary of stinging, spitting, and exploding creatures and plant life also add to the mix of peril and puzzles. Characters will ask for things, like submissions to plundered museums, and in return, reward you with tools for continuance. Swimming, climbing, jumping, and running can at times be augmented by spells, which make these actions momentarily godlike. So if you like doing this, and you like doing this, and you think this room looks pretty cool, you're going to dig this game. Our only frown came from endless text screens instead of voice acting, and that our hero here really didn't have much of a personality. Lights are on, nobody's home. Overall, though, we Sphinx it's cool. We give it a 4 out of 5.
And the developer THQ is looking to build a franchise out of this one, and if they can make the main character more interesting, I think they'll be well on their way.
They should give him a goatee. Well, that worked for Jack and Jack 2. They should do
that. They could try that.
Actually, probably.
But don't worry, you know what? We have just enough time for viewer mail.
No!
Yes!
No!
Today's viewer mail is from Brian in Selins Grove, Pennsylvania. He writes, hello, my question is about the myth of playing PS2 or Xbox on big screen projection style TVs versus flat screen or plasma TVs. I have heard from sales staff at several retailers that constant game playing can cause permanent so-called burning marking of the screen. Well, Brian, here's the deal. If you look behind us, you can see our screen right there. You can see it's normal. And then you can see that actually there's an image burned into it, and that's from just having the logo up all the time. Burn-in is a problem. And you know, if you even watch the same television station all the time,
it can happen.
The little
bug in the corner. Also, you can get burning if you set it on fire.
That would be another way to deal with it.
Yeah.
Good night.
Today on X-Play, we can't believe we're showing you Shell Shock, NAM 67. More clicking in Myst 4. And naked elf women and champions return to arms. Oops, he died. It's game time. Please welcome some people on this show, Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
Hello and welcome to X-Play, the show that brings you brutally honest video game reviews.
And today, the brutality is everywhere.
From a game about a painful chapter in American history, the Vietnam War.
To a game where elves and bikinis stab people. We have plenty of violence for the whole family.
But don't worry, we also have Myst 4 for the oh-so-cerebral PC gamers out there.
Exist. And a new Time Crisis shoot-em-up for the Gun Con owners. All three of them.
And a new Paper Mario RPG that will enchant GameCube fans of all ages.
And speaking of enchantment, why not start with a game about Vietnam?
I can think of a lot of reasons.
And I can ignore them. Here's a review of Shell Shock, NAM 67.
Dear Robert McNamara, thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot for manufacturing that police action that has resulted in so many, many annoying games situated in that humid tropical death trap. Look at this. This is Shell Shock NAM 67. And it sucks more than the oxygen the flames consumed during that little Dresden maneuver you pulled off. It's apparently an attempt at offering a grittier, more realistic depiction of Vietnam for your entertainment. It's grittier because it shows us mass slaughter for our entertainment. It's grittier because there's visual grain, or grit, because people's vision sucked until 2 decades ago. Though, to be honest, Shell Shock is to teaching us war realism as porn is to teaching us how to talk during sex. Yeah, that's it, baby. Right there. Because, according to the developers, the Vietnam War was fought on a series of set paths with cohorts who seem to be impervious to enemy fire.
Advance! Yeah!
And the Vietnamese would speak English.
We're gonna get you, G.I.
English written by Shane Black.
We're gonna get you.
We're here to help, G.I. Want USA to win war.
To hell with you all!
And enemies would be this dirt stupid. You know, if they were, it wouldn't be called Ho Chi Minh City, you jackasses. Oh, but thank God they included all the edgy fun at the periphery.
We make good boom boom. We party if you got lots of chips.
Because what's Vietnam without the local whores? I no play you a long time. You get the sense this is based less on Vietnam than movies purporting to be a realistic depiction of Vietnam.
You see all these cherries walking around? Looks like one big f***ing kindergarten around here.
The game is just generic and bland. Missions are no more inspired than the usual blow something up,
destroy that tunnel,
and kill people. Oh yeah, there's the occasional stealth mission. Hold on, hold on. Nope, I'm not excited. The best the game has to offer is that there are traps laid in your path you need to look out for and defuse. But calling that a plus is like being thankful the execution bullet isn't hollow-tipped.
Waste of a good soldier.
The game is so uninspired, it just serves to make the violence seem all the more tawdry and mean-spirited. You want realism? How about this? I like to think this might be the end of games that cheapen and distort the Vietnam War by wallowing in the very horror show they purport to be appalled at. And while we're at it, let's find the WMDs as well.
What the hell did you do, Kowalski? You really going psycho?
If you're thinking of playing this, grab a copy of Dispatches instead. I'll buy a 2 out of 5.
Keep on moving!
I can't believe you put Nixon and McNamara's faces on your reticle. I've seen Fog of War, Adam, and you are no Errol Morris.
It's okay. No one knows what you're talking about, Senator Benson.
And he's in C-SPAN. And by the way, Who's buying these games?
I want to know this. Who out there is going, hey, remember that really unpleasant chapter in U.S. history? Let's relive it.
I think the Vietnam game boom happened because the market is so oversaturated with World War II games. And of course, the Panama conflict was too short to make a first-person shooter.
Of course, shooters don't always have to be based on wars. And actually, you can just shoot people that just shoot people.
Yeah, like Time Crisis, Crisis Zone, which may be one of the last games on Earth to use a gun con. If only guns in real life were so whimsically colored. Here's our review.
Everyday life can be a little too tidy sometimes. Clean, orderly, civilized. That is until you're faced with a crisis. A time crisis. In a crisis zone. Publisher Namco embraces the envelope with its release of Time Crisis Crisis Zone, a port of the coin-op version from 1999. Even if you consider the included light gun, is a five-year-old game worth $60?
Damn, you're annoying.
This game has a unique take on what terrorism is. There's no unshaven, haggard men storming planes or attacking military checkpoints here. Instead, everyone has matching outfits. The well-groomed leader wears a jaunty cap, and they're taking over a mall. Yep, shop early and avoid the bullets. For lack of a better word, your enemies are dimwits. Mostly, they just stand out in the open. When they do take cover, their choices are dubious. Here's one career-limiting idea. When being shot, hide behind a ski rack. And the heroes aren't geniuses either. One broken elevator stumps these guys. Ooh, stairs go up too. Fortunately, pulling a trigger is a fairly brainless activity, and there's no time to think anyway due to the sheer number of enemies crowding the screen. Normally, it's hard to recruit this many terrorists. Maybe they get matching 401k. I wish I did. Besides people, almost everything can be shot to hell. Shoot jars, shoot CDs, shoot corn. This game trashes so much art, you'd think it was made by the NEA. Although your targets are mostly generic troops, the challenging boss fights stand out and add variety. Like this speedboat. This tank. These guys, actually quite graceful. Too bad I gotta kill you. I prefer murderizing people in luxury surroundings. Enjoy a spin of roulette. Fine dining. And sumptuous morsels from a world-class kitchen. As you lay waste to those who oppose you.
I'm taking you down!
Crisis Zone provides the same trembling head rush that Time Crisis is known for. Twitch fans will be stoked. For everyone else, it's probably a rental. A 3 out of 5.
Thank you.
Time Crisis Crisis Zone may be one of the last gun games ever released.
It's sad, but apparently Duck Hunt, with its colorful bird death, was the height of the light gun era.
Sure, we moved from shooting 8-bit ducks to pre-rendered people, but it's just not the same without the dog that pops up and laughs at you.
I pop up and laugh at you when you play light gun games.
Yes, but that's more emasculating than funny.
It's funny.
Coming up, time to party with Myst 4.
Hey, it's free t-shirts. We're going to fire them off. Here it comes, and boom, nice shot. Good catch, young lady. In the audience, we've got more coming. Well, we got a little smoke problem coming out there. Oh, a little malfunction. Oh. Look there on the side, guys. Pull the hose. Oh, a little... Best to clear the courts. Ho! Oh.
Hey.
No. Hey.
Okay, here.
Here. Mm-mm.
All right.
My man.
Bye-bye.
Yeah. Everyone's talking double because of Domino's new Double Melt Pizza. Layer upon layer of flavor with a creamy blend of cheeses and herbs between two thin crusts. Buy your medium one-topping Double Melt Pizza for $9.99 and get any second medium pizza for just $5 more.
Hey, don't.
Get the door. It's Domino's new Double Melt Pizza.
Screaming, tag-teaming swingers. Dixie and Diddy team up with new friends to save the big ape. Donkey Kong Country 2, only for Game Boy Advance. Rated E for everyone.
This Wednesday,
Merry Christmas!
Enter a world filled with Christmas magic.
Ooh.
Christmas with the Cranks is the perfect way to kick off the Christmas season.
I'll get the ham.
A four-star holiday comedy.
The ham is right!
Hilarious and heartwarming.
It's the greatest time of year.
Tim Allen has never been funnier.
Isn't that against the law?
It's the best gift you'll get this Christmas.
I'm coming home for Christmas!
Christmas with the Cranks.
Put the real delicate ones on the sofa.
Rated PG. Opens everywhere Wednesday.
Hey you, get MCSE, Cisco, or A-Plus certified, guaranteed, with Smart Certify's fast and easy IT certification courses. You'll earn more money and have more job security once you're IT certified. Listen to this.
If it wasn't for Smart Certify, I'd still be working a dead-end tech support job.
Let me tell you, there's no better way to pass the IT exams than by using these courses.
I've done tons of IT training, but Smart Certify's MCSE course was the best by far.
Smart Certify has one-on-one mentoring and a money-back guarantee. I couldn't lose.
Now it's easy to advance your career as a certified IT professional. Call 1-877-TRAINING today and mention code IT to take a free course title. Or go online at www.smartcertifydirect.com. That's toll-free at 1-877-TRAINING or www.smartcertifydirect.com. Get your free course now.
You're a big, fine gamer. Won't you back that thing up? It's Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
Hello, and welcome back to X-Play, the show that brings you PC nostalgia.
Yes, in 1995, the original Myst was a breakthrough in PC gaming. It was beautifully pre-rendered, back before pre-rendered was a dirty word.
Now, the gameplay itself may have been tedious.
May?
But at least it looked pretty.
All right. Now there's a fourth Myst game, and the gameplay is finally catching up to the graphics.
Here's a review of Myst 4.
Myst, the self-proclaimed greatest adventure saga, is back with Myst 4, Revelation, bringing with it strange new ages and complex puzzles. You have been summoned to Tamana by Atris, the author of Myst's famous linking books. His wife wishes to see their evil sons released from their prison ages, but Atris is not convinced they have repented their wicked ways.
I must find out if either Cirrus or Aghanar deserve to be freed, and you're the only one we can trust.
You have been brought in as an objective viewer to judge if the sons can be trusted, and apparently to babysit Atris's daughter.
Keep an eye on Yisha, will you?
Atris, maybe if you spent some time with your sons, they wouldn't have become evil.
I thought I was the only devious one in our family.
Completely CG sets, bad acting, and ridiculous writing. Maybe George Lucas directed these scenes.
How are we supposed to maintain contact with the ancestors if we can't harvest any globes?
Obviously, no one is playing Myst because they want to see great theater. It's about solving complex puzzles so you can pretend you're smarter than other gamers. Those Neanderthals who just like to see things explode couldn't possibly comprehend these intricate puzzles the way I can. Just spin this, and then this one, and I've just shown you how to solve the puzzle of the mischievous stove. Actually, solving the puzzles isn't as difficult as just figuring out how the puzzle works in the first place.
God, this is hard.
You'll want to explore as much of the ages as possible before trying to tackle any of the major puzzles. Most clues can be found in journals, so like Prime Mother, you can read their fascinating stories.
Mom and me started the fun club and looked at stars.
Hey, is that an image recorder you've got? How cool!
Yes, the futuristic image recorder, otherwise known as a camera. The camera is extremely helpful, allowing you to take pictures of important information. That way, you don't have to trudge across the island to find it again. Ah, my hand's on fire! Well, Myst 4 isn't the greatest adventure saga of all time, it is the best Myst sequel. The visuals bring the worlds alive, and even the full motion video segments keep you entertained.
God, this is hard.
The puzzles are difficult and will take large amounts of time to complete, filling you with unequaled joy if you are able to solve them. and an all-consuming shame and humiliation if you can't.
God, this is hard.
Plus, there's a Peter Gabriel song, because he has nothing better to do. We give Myst 4 Revelations a 4 out of 5.
Yes. Now, aside from the Siberia series, this is still one of the best point-and-click games.
Although the acting, not so good. I think there's a community theater production of Uncle Vanya that wants its cast back.
That comment is sort of ironic coming from us.
What do you mean? Are you saying we're bad actors?
No.
Up next, extras from the musical Cats kill things in Champions Return to Arms.
This holiday, buy a sleek i710, get one free. Buy the turbocharged i736, get one free. All Nextel phones have built-in walkie-talkie and GPS capability. Double your giving power. Call 8888-NEXTEL to shop or find a store. Act now. Get two i710 phones for $89.99. Call 8888-NEXTEL now.
Electric shivers across my skin. It's like a fever, and you're my only medicine.
Could I be dreaming your touch?
Touch, new from Axe.
When am I supposed to add this?
Snoop wants to know when to add the fabric softener.
Tricky, depends whether it's top-loading machine or front-loading.
Snoop does his own laundry? That's hot.
Snoop, you're cuddly enough as it is.
Did your mother teach you anything?
Fabric softener, so that's how those hip-hop guys get all the chicks.
The new T-Mobile Sidekick 2, with IM, phone, web, and more.
Everybody needs a sidekick.
What are you setting your sights on? And when you see it, will you be ready? Just pick up the phone, dial 1-800-645-ARMY, and you'll get this free DVD. You'll learn about the hundreds of opportunities the Army can offer you. Skills, education, healthcare. Call 1-800-645-ARMY, and you'll also get this free boonie hat. Whatever you're looking for, the Army can help you find it.
I'm Matthew Lesko, and my new book will tell you how to tell bill collectors to go shove it! My new book shows you 4,000 government programs that you can use to pay your bills and get out of debt forever! Get $2,000 to pay your rent or mortgage, or $600 to pay your phone bill, or even $7,000 to pay your credit card bills. I've been researching government grants for over 25 years, and government officials don't even know about these programs. And you've never seen a book that's so easy to use. Here's a program to pay for your prescription drug bills, or a program to pay for your living expenses, or programs to pay for your housing bills, apartment bills, or even your student loans. Over 80% of the people in the United States, including millionaires, are eligible. Isn't it about time you get rid of your debt once and for all? If you don't use these programs, somebody else will. So call now and get free money to pay your bills.
Call 1-800-709-6633 now.
Stay tuned. Robot Wars, next.
You are getting very sleepy. It's Adam Sessler and... yawn.
Welcome back to X-Play.
We have returned with an EverQuest spin-off for the PS2.
Now, technically, it's a sequel to Champions of Norrath, but this one is an online action RPG that lets you hack and slash your way through the EverQuest universe.
Delightful.
Here's a review of Champions Return to Arms.
Did they not have arms in the first game?
Coming soon to a dark pizza box doom dungeon near you is the latest offline chapter in the EverQuest universe, Champions Return to Arms. Last time out, the dark god Inoruk was defeated, but he exploded into tiny shards of pure evil. Careful, a cut from that stuff is worse than coral. Of course, the heroes are trying to dustbuster up the pieces once and for all, while the villains are trying to put the bits back together like an evil god Lego playset. They're all the standard swords and sorcery characters in both He-Man and She-Ra versions. You can even import your characters from Champions of Norrath. New this time around are the Ikshar Shaman, fork-tongued beasties like poison tree frogs on steroids, and the Vashir Berserkers, who have burly human bodies and the heads and markings of lions and tigers and, well, pumas and cheetahs and other kinds of tigers. Once you've picked your character, your next stop is the Plane of War. Get ready to hack and slash. And then slash and hack some more. What sets this title apart from your average dungeon crawler are the divergent good and evil storylines. You begin on the Plane of Tranquility. You know, blonde woman, blue skies, fluffy clouds, good guy stuff. But soon after, you're offered the chance to switch to the dark side, to the fiery Plane of Fear, with the dangerous and evil brunette, Natasla.
I've taken my destiny into my own hands. Join us and we will rule this world through the power of hate.
Okay. And what fantasy game wouldn't be complete without gravitationally immune women? How convenient that their armor comes off like that. Hey, elf lady, interested in a bloodbath?
I'd be glad to.
That's not what I meant, but whatever. Unfortunately, they live longer when they're not, dressed like Red Sonja. Even more unfortunately, men can also be stripped to their Conan underoos. Why do they do that?
They'll pay for this.
Characters can build up to level 80, so there'll be plenty of time to learn fancy spells, find enchanted weapons and armor, and collect gold, gold, and gold. For pure fighting. There's an arena where you can turn wave after wave of enemies into lunch meat. Except for the samurai, they're self-slicing. So convenient. This new champions looks like a big improvement with better textures and more dense models. The levels are gorgeous. Zoom in and you can see your hero and your swarming enemies are all well detailed and smoothly animated. There are even hints of a player versus player option.
Very tantalizing.
We're looking forward to seeing this one Valentine's Day next year.
Let the beating begin. Who wants it first?
Oh, for once, fighting in your underwear has realistic consequences. People, if I give you only one piece of advice, it is this. Dress your elves in armor. Bikinis don't deflect swords well.
But they do distract your enemies. And 13-year-old boys. And grown men. And me.
Coming up, Nintendo goes 2D in Paper Mario.
Music. You love it, you live it, you definitely need it. Well, Circuit City has everything you need to turn your PC and broadband connection into the hub of your home entertainment experience.
First, start building your digital song library by downloading the newest tunes from music services like Music Now, found at www.circuitcity.com/musicnow. The next step is to pump your favorite tunes throughout your home wirelessly. The Linksys Wireless G broadband router allows you to share your broadband connection with a wireless media receiver like the WM6000, Creative Wireless Music System. Now you can enjoy the music on your PC in any room you choose. The WM6000 includes a wireless RF remote with a large LCD screen that lets you view and choose songs or playlists without needing a monitor. You can add up to 4 wireless receivers throughout your home, allowing 4 separate streams of digital music, all from one PC.
This is just one of the ways that enhanced home networking is improving the quality of our day-to-day lives. To learn more about networking and other digital solutions, as well as broadband services, visit your local Circuit City store or log on to the new CircuitCity.com.
What's this? It's how Windows Media Video streamed from the web would look on your TV.
If you had the MSN TV2 Internet and Media Player with service from Microsoft,
it lets you stream Windows Media compatible video, music, and photos from the Internet or your PC onto your TV. You can even access the Internet, do email, and more, all within your comfort zone.
The new MSN TV2 Internet and Media Player. Call or go online now.
Sir Kill-A-Lot, Mr. Psycho, Fluffy, the world's greatest metallic murder machines in an all-or-nothing battle to the death. Get that toaster out of here. This rig is for robots. Robot Wars. New episode coming up next.
I should be hosting X-Play. I know every name of every creator of every major game released in the last 25 years. It's okay.
X-Play, weeknights at 11.
Once again, two people still stuck in San Fierro, Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb.
I'm almost at Las Venturas. I just need a couple more hours.
Welcome back to X-Play.
We have an RPG for the GameCube starring everyone's favorite plumber.
G. Gordon Liddy.
I'm talking about Mario.
That's right.
This sequel is already a hit in Japan, and now it's arrived in the States. Here's our review of Paper Mario, the Thousand Year Door.
That damn princess has wandered off again. How can she be so headstrong and so helpless at the same time? You think she'd carry mace under that hoop skirt of hers? Maybe that's a bad idea. Anyway, Mario takes off to find her in another refreshing, humorous RPG from Nintendo, Paper Mario, the Thousand Year Door. I mean, aren't we all a little sick of disenfranchised orphans with big eyes wistfully trying to save the world from demon kings?
I'm sure your parents are okay.
Huh, I'm not. Like most RPGs, you're gonna have to be a good reader to play Paper Mario. Not that the text is complicated or anything, there's just a lot of it. Did he just tell me to buy a Nintendo game? Props for being self-referential, but you're still a Nintendo toady. The combat is where Thousand Year Door really shines. These games aren't based on rolls of the dice, they're based on your accurate timing. From hitting A just before you jump on someone for extra damage, to tapping along to a complicated pattern for a more deadly attack. You're also competing on a stage, and the audience can be brutal. But the better a show you put on, the more star points you get. And you use the star points to pull off tricks and bonuses. The audience can also play tricks on you for some damage. Though you can run out into the crowd and get the heckler out of there. Mario doesn't have to go his adventure alone. He starts out with Goombella, a Goomba with a ponytail and a hard hat. But Mario is a jovial and trusting fellow, and he makes lots more friends. The best part is that he can switch them out on the fly. This is where the combat gets really interesting. And it adds a lot of strategy that really updates the tired old RPG formula. The style at first seems a little saccharine. But the whole thing is so self-consciously absurd, it starts to make sense. The paper theme is carried throughout, and since Mario himself is made out of paper, he can transform or fold himself into other things, like paper airplanes. And his allies can help him solve puzzles with their own special abilities. There's so much going on in the Thousand Year Door, yet they've still kept it accessible to RPG newbies and fun for the veterans out there. Now, it's really not much different from the first Paper Mario, but we don't care. It's just two helpings of yummy. Paper Mario, the Thousand Year Door gets a 4 out of 5.
You know, it also seems similar to Mario & Luigi Superstar Saga.
Oh, it is. It uses the same badge system to, like, upgrade the characters. Mario has the hammer, and he has a jump attack, just like in Superstar Saga. Although, I have to say, I really enjoyed playing in the Thousand Year Door. It's one of the few Cube exclusives out there. Well,
that's because Resident Evil 4, the biggest GameCube exclusive of next year, is coming out on the PS2.
You hear that wet thunking sound? That's the spike going through the GameCube's heart.
I guess it is possible there could be one other exclusive, Zelda, coming out next year, but that never seems to come out when we want it to come out. Though I have to say, for all you PS2 owners, I can't imagine how they're going to fit that game onto the PS2.
Resident Evil?
It just can't look as good.
And it comes out after the GameCube version, so
right, like
if you really want it that day, nope. You got to get the GameCube
version. I don't know. Go cry in your soup.
Good night.
Do you have soup?
We'll be right back.